Yeah, I'm robbery, the kidnap, perverting the course of justice. I've had the police come round about the 53 million because I know the fella that's done it. Murder, numerous assaults. I'm actually on trial at the moment for a firearm.
Despite endless accusations, Ian Tucker has never been convicted of any serious offence. But he's about to be tried for possession of a firearm. Tucker's luck may be about to run out.
Some of them I have been responsible for, but I don't think that I've ever dished out an hiding to anybody that didn't deserve it. People are left under no illusions, and they know what the situation is. You've only got to look at me.
North Kent, the Garden of England, gateway to London and home to Ian Tucker.
Who said fucking turn left?
All right, I'm waiting for you to say something. We'll hear it said.
Listen, shut up.
I'm just trying to tell you where it is.
Don't tell me nothing. Who told you to turn left? Follow the road, I said. Because you just go the wrong fucking way and get yourself all wrapped round. See what I mean? I don't know where I'm coming or going after sitting here, mate, with you fucking 20 minutes. Oh.
Ian Tucker is a legend in Kent's underworld, a former doorman, debt collector, and minder to the Cray twins. He was once dubbed one of the UK's most wanted men.
Hello, mate. My name's Ian.
Kent police have been watching Tucker for years, but have never had the evidence to put him behind bars.
Any idea what it says on your police file?
Yeah. 6'2", scar above left eye, approach with caution. But I don't know where they're coming from. I suppose they have got a little bit of history of me being violent. But, you know, everyone has their moments.
Tucker plays by his own rules and operates an alternative criminal justice system. When a Rolex was stolen from a friend, he acted as judge and jury and meted out his own punishment.
I asked the fellow about it, whether it was anything to do with him. And he denied it strongly. About a week after that, I got a phone call say that he was offering a watch in the pub. The minute I saw him or set eyes on him, I just filled him in. Because I think what he done is took a diabolical liberty. I even took a picture of him on my phone after I beat him up. And there's a fella there.
He looks a bit bruised there, doesn't he?
He looks like he's seen better days.
What did he say when you confronted him?
Ouch. Power in the blood, justice in the soul. When that call it comes, I will be ready for war. Power in the blood, justice in the soul. When that call it comes, I'll
Tucker's turf is known as the Corridor of Crime, a stretch of road along the Thames estuary, linking the gangs of southeast London to the lucrative docks of North Kent. Tucker has carved out a niche for himself, specializing in resolving underworld disputes. His commission is 50% on debts collected, and hundreds of thousands of pounds have passed through his hands. His career really took off in the 90s when he teamed up with Dave Courtney, dubbed the celebrity gangster for his many autobiographies and television appearances.
He wanted someone bashed up, rent a clump, debt collection, car repossession, brand squatters out. He's quite a force on his own, is Mr. Tucker here.
The pair formed a formidable debt collecting partnership. They were up for anything, from cash to cars, and on one occasion, even a golf course.
We met and it was an instant love. It was like a Mills and Boone all over again. It was like, I found my lost soul.
And we made some noise, didn't we?
Tucker and Courtney became inseparable, and when they weren't collecting debts, they provided muscle for some of the top West End nightclubs. Together, they were a force to be reckoned with.
And that particular night, we left there, didn't we? We went down to the Kentucky, and we were standing there, minding our own business in the queue. Right, dingy little place. And this black fella walks in. He must have been about 7 foot. Big head, big snorkel coat on. Oh, monster.
Looking after his own set of prostitutes, and we was with two little birds that were just been raving, so they looked like tarts. And he thought we were obviously pimping these two birds on his back.
He must terrorise the whole of King's Cross, this fella. He's a big, horrible... Anyway, you know, just say the word to a girl, you know, and they do the business, do they?
He walks out of the shop, and we both just swallowed it, so for about 2 seconds, we both sit there going, oh, fuck, I can't have that.
I can't have that. He went, I can't have that. I went, no, nor can I. We went out the door like a shot. He went left and I went right. But I got him. He said, I really think you're... I went, crack, I've hit him. Oh, he's hit the floor first. It was a lovely one, wasn't it? We was going to Manchester the next day. All of a sudden, he burst out laughing. I said, what's the matter with you? He just said, wherever that fella's woke up today, wherever he is, he's woke up. Don't go in that Kentucky, fuck.
We were the Morecambe and Wires. We brought the entertainment value into the crime itself.
Despite little acting experience, the two were cast as gangsters in The Bill to give the show added realism.
Me and him sitting on a stage in my nightclub, in my suit, with my missus at my table, with my best pal, playing Dave and Ian, who's with him.
Officer. Now shut it!
Besides television, their image was used to promote nightclubs, posing here for a poster outside the Blind Beggar, the pub made famous by the Cray twins. While Courtney Cray's celebrity, Tucker found it more convenient to keep a low profile. Their status in the underworld reached its peak when they were enlisted by the infamous London crime boss, Reggie Cray, to organise the security for brother Ronnie's funeral in 1995.
It was the East End send-off that Ronnie Cray planned in his prison cell and requested before his death. From early morning, security men hired by the Cray family encircled the funeral parlour in Bethnal Green, where the procession would begin.
Tucker had also been trusted with standing vigil over the corpse of Ronnie Cray the night before the funeral. Tucker now claims to have a regular job, but has kept the trappings of his former life. A diamond-studded Rolex and luxury cars. He lives with his wife and daughter in a leafy suburb near Gravesend in North Kent. However, his past has a habit of catching up with him, as he discovered shortly after the murder of Jill Dando. Many suspected it was an underworld contract killing designed to silence the voice of Crime Watch. And Tucker was a prime suspect. Ian Tucker, a notorious figure in Kent's underworld, has had many brushes with the law. In 1999, Crime Watch broadcast his face to millions of living rooms up and down the country. A moment that would change his life forever.
Take the BBC, I want to be on Baywatch, not Crime Watch. They messed it right up.
And another unpleasant crime. Two men abducted at gunpoint in the West End of London in what seems to have been a feud.
Tucker was wanted by the police in connection with an armed kidnapping.
We actually went and had a chat with somebody that had knocked somebody for £200,000. So I said, listen, you're coming with us. We better go and have a chat with the fella you owe the money to. And while we was leaving, the fella went, call the police, call the police. And made out that he was being kidnapped and God knows what else, which is a total load of shit. But I had about 5 seconds to decide what it looked like, and it weren't looking good from where I was seeing it, so we all done the off.
The victim managed to escape and raise the alarm. Tucker decided to go on the run.
And detectives are now trying to trace two men. First, Ian Ronald Tucker, 6'2", fit, with short fair hair and...
Scar above left eye, earring, Rolex watch. My mother couldn't have described me any better. I was supposed to be the gunman, and there was never a gun there. The fact that I'd actually done nothing wrong, and I knew I'd done nothing wrong, and it was just, I knew which way it was going to go, obviously I could have thought to be a bit cheekier.
Unimpressed by the photo Crime Watch had used of him, Tucker called the show and complained, offering to send in a better one.
But we have an apology to make. Apparently one of the photos we showed last month
is deeply unflattering.
We know this because, astonishingly, Ian Ronald Tucker rang the
police officer to have a chat.
police still think these are pretty good pictures, and if you've seen either of these men, please give us a ring. 0500 600 600.
After 9 months on the run, the police dropped all charges against Tucker and he was free to return home.
To this day, I've never ever been questioned about what I was supposed to be, what they put me on there in front of 6 million viewers as an armed robber and a kidnapper, and to this day, no one's ever spoke to me about it. I had a calf, they ruined the calf. So I was then on the phone to Crime Watch, screaming at them, saying, listen, I want an apology. The fact that, you know, you've told all these people that I'm an armed robber and a kidnapper, you've now ruined my business. I'm sorry, we don't give apologies.
From now on, any criminal on Crime Watch will be featured all around the globe. So, unless we're seeking you, don't have nightmares.
The negative publicity forced Tucker's thriving cafe to close. His grudge with Crime Watch was now personal.
Good evening. The TV personality Jill Dando, who as Crime Watch presenter helped to send dozens of criminals to jail, was murdered on her own doorstep today. She was killed by a single gunshot to her head.
When Jill Dando was murdered in what appeared to be a professional hit, Tucker found himself in the frame.
Next minute, mate of mine, Colin, rang me up. He said, just take time out and just remember exactly where you was and what you were doing. All right, Jill Dando's just been shot. Wow.
Tonight, the mystery over her death deepened with speculation that the killing may have been revenge for her anti-crime work.
Tucker's violent past, access to firearms and grudge with Crime Watch made him an obvious suspect. He was hauled in for questioning on three separate occasions.
Just because I had jumped the Crime Watch, you know, they wanted to start interviewing me about the mysterious shooting of Jill Dando.
And what did they suggest you had done?
Well, they wanted to know where I was at the time.
Tucker was later released without charge. He had a cast iron alibi.
I was in Doncaster repossessing some vehicles.
Tucker has made a living through repossessions and is often asked to recover cars.
This is your car?
Yeah, indeed. Just nicked it.
Though he paid for this one, that hasn't always been the case.
You've had some nice motors over the years.
We've had a few, yeah, definitely.
Yeah, would you definitely say you're a car man, a petrol head?
This is, yeah, it's a 5-litre engine.
5-litre engine. How fast?
89 now.
And have you tested it?
Every day. It says on my licence, tear along the dotted line.
Yeah.
So I do.
I can slow down if you want. Oh, that is fast. Oh my god, that's very fast. Oh my god. Okay. You can slow down if you want. Yeah. Oh my god. Oh, you nutcase.
Tucker's need for speed doesn't go unnoticed, and all too often he finds himself in the dock. On this occasion, he's been caught driving whilst banned and then giving a false name and address. He's been summoned to appear before the magistrates.
Basically, just been in court for driving whilst disqualified. Bit of a shock to the system, really. I've just got a smack on the bum and £300 fine. No further disqualification. Off you go. Thank you very much. Can I drive home? Well, it could have been a custodial. That was the worst way I was looking at it. And to get a £300 fine was absolutely gorgeous. Pay it today. Thank you very much. I can't do that.
Constant driving bans are the least of Tucker's worries. He's currently facing up to 8 years in jail. Police investigating an attempted murder raided his home and found a loaded firearm wrapped in a plastic bag. Tucker's defense is that the gun is not his, and he's now trying to find evidence to support the claim.
There is no fingerprints, there is no overwhelming evidence, apart from it was in my house. They never charged my missus for it, they charged me for it. She's a joint owner of a mortgage, why didn't they charge her for it? You tell me.
Tucker maintains that the gun belongs to a friend who was staying at his house at the time. Naturally, the prosecution don't believe him.
The prosecution's case is that I've actually bullied somebody into putting their hands up to accepting full responsibility for that.
And they think that, you know, somebody would do an aid stretch for you. Somebody would do 8 years in jail for you.
Obviously, quite clearly, yeah, they think that. That's why they've nicked me and not the other fella. Everyone's put on a speeding fine, you know, like that, or had been flashed and put their wife's name on it. But, you know, this is, you know, we're talking about minimum of a seven stretch. That's serious prison. If I was guilty, I would say, I would come clean and say, listen, I'm pulling a stroke here. I've got somebody to do this, blah, blah, blah. You know, that's not the case.
Although the police think that's the case.
Obviously they think that there's a, you know, there's a red herring somewhere, or someone's been drafted in to take the blame or whatever. But who do you know that would stand there and put their hands up to an eight? Do you know, you know, you couldn't buy that person, you know, 500 grand wouldn't buy that person. Well, it wouldn't buy me, would it buy you?
The man the police accuse of taking the rap for Tucker is friend Sydney. He confessed to police that the gun was his the day after it was found.
Well done, Sydney. Well, mate, see that, Cassie? Tell her, mate. See that, Ruby. Tell her, mate.
What can you say about Sydney? Sydney. As I say, we've known each other for about 20-odd years. And for whatever reason,
you've always been there for me.
I've always been in his corner, which I would like to think has been a big advantage to him.
In
more ways than one. You know, he was living up here for a while when he came out of prison. He, for whatever reason, put a loaded firearm in my garage, and we're still trying to sort it out now.
I didn't mean for it to be loaded because I know the baby's here, but I was playing with it. I didn't leave it in the house.
No,
it
was
I did
in
leave
the garage.
It outside.
Yeah.
But I only got that for my own protection. I was on the drugs, I was on the crack cocaine, I was on the heroin, I was paranoid. And someone offered me that because it was only a couple of months before that a few travelling men, gypsies, pikers, whatever you want to call them, tried dragging me in the back of a van, saying I'd done wrong. But I knew that it could help me at the time. You only got to show it. At the end of the day, people ain't got to know if you can pull the trigger or not.
There he is, 6 foot 2, large as life, telling you straight exactly what's gone on.
I promise you, that was mine. If I'd have known I was going to cause this much trouble, I would never have left it here.
No one could ever imagine that it was going to go as pear-shaped as this. You know, I didn't even raise my voice. I just went, listen, Sydney, it's got to be sorted out. I went and got him boozed up. He went straight down there. He went, I'll sort it out. Leave it with me.
I had to. After what you'd done for me, I'd come off the drugs, onto the drink,
But his long criminal record, history of drug abuse, and the fact he was drunk at the time of the confession prevented the police from taking him seriously.
Sydney was in there, putting his hands up, telling them exactly what was going on. They didn't even want to interview him.
They didn't believe it was mine from day one. They're saying it's Ian's, and Ian, they said to me, even though Ian's over threatened you to take the blame.
I don't know who would have been spiteful enough to say that.
I would not go to prison for you, nobody. Not for 5 years.
We've got everybody that we need to actually put a case forward now. But I've left no, I'm no stones unturned. We've got everybody that we need now that's relevant, I think, yeah. Don't you? But he's worth his weight in gold, Sydney.
Until now, Tucker's luck has served him well. The trial has collapsed twice previously. But the prosecution are determined to get their man, citing exceptional circumstances to justify a third trial. Tucker believes Kent police are out to get him.
What do the police accuse you of doing?
Everything and more. Pearl Harbor, Titanic, it was all my fault. Whatever they want to, you know, if something happens in any particular area near me, I'll get a visit.
Over the years, Kent has spawned some of Britain's biggest criminal masterminds. And Tucker has been linked to them all.
And I've been some clever bastards.
In 1983, six men broke into the Brinks Mat warehouse at Heathrow Airport and stole £26 million worth of gold bullion.
Okie dokie. Oh.
notorious Kent villain Kenny Noy was convicted of conspiracy to handle the gold bullion and was sentenced to 14 years in jail. In November 2000, a gang of five men from Kent and southeast London attempted to steal 12 extremely rare diamonds. Most recently, £53 million was stolen from a Securitas depot in Tonbridge.
A massive police search is underway for the gang that pulled off the biggest ever armed robbery in Britain. Detectives say the theft was a meticulously planned operation.
In February 2006, at least six gang members, armed and masked, tied up staff before loading millions of pounds into a van.
We've got callous, professional gangsters that we need to catch. In Kent Police, we've got a track record for doing so, and we're going to bring these people to book, but we need your help to do so.
I've had the police come round about the 53 million a few times so far.
And what did they say to you?
Basically, because I know the fella that's done it, and they know I know him, I think that was one of the reasons I got raided last time, just so they could have a look at my phones, see if I'd been ringing, where, you know, give him a clue where he's at.
And did you have anything to do with the 53 million?
Absolutely nothing to do with it whatsoever.
Are you gutted that you didn't have anything to do with it?
Oh, listen, I've got to be honest, I would have been tempted to go on that, I imagine.
Ian Lucky Tucker is facing up to 8 years in jail if found guilty of possessing a firearm. Keen to keep his nose clean for the time being, he has taken on a legitimate job.
We've just arrived at Lewisham, where a customer needs to sign his finance agreement. Any excuse for him to not sign, and we don't get paid for it.
The doorbell wasn't working. Sorry.
Tucker has started working for an old school friend who owns a large furniture company.
I went to her see her today. She has had some furniture. She's got a bedroom outstanding. So I'm going to redo her paperwork accordingly, change her onto her finance, and she'll do a new finance agreement for what.
That'll do. Fucking lovely.
Luckily, I know her people.
Lovely.
She's working for. They're old gangsters as well.
Renowned for his ability to defuse a situation, Tucker operates as a troubleshooter. His job is to make sure finance agreements have been signed, missing payments collected, and customer complaints dealt with. It's a 24-hour job. At 9 o'clock that evening, Tucker receives a call. There's been a fight with a customer at one of the shops, and his boss has been arrested.
No, listen, so don't worry. I know you'd sit there for, you have done it for me, mate, so it's not a problem at all.
His boss has been charged with assault, and instead of calling a solicitor, he uses his one permitted phone call to ring Tucker.
Listen, do me a favour. After speaking to my solicitor, he has advised me to say no comment. Nothing more than that. Don't, you know, forget, listen, they're not helping you, so bollocks to helping them. At the end of the day, they've held you for absolutely nothing for 8 hours. Fuck them, right? If it's a wrong decision, you then blame your solicitor. Bollocks to them. After speaking to your brief, he's advised you to say no comment. End of. End of. Don't give me any. Yeah, at the end of the day, they're being proper bastards. We've just arrived now at Stoke Newington Police Station, where I'm going to park up. And see if we can get him out. Stoke Newington Police Station. What a toilet that is.
Tucker's experience with the police helps secure bail.
Wherever you go, you're going to have people in the area that are very influential. For people that don't know me, I would be the first to admit that I do look quite frightened. I'd like to say that I was reasonably honest. I've never fucked anyone. Can't be bought. I've never heard anybody referring to me as a bully. Treat them as you'd like to be treated, I think.
Shades on. If you're gonna cry, keep your shades on.
Another day brings another challenge. Tucker has been asked by a friend to help recover a big debt.
Right, listen. I've just left your property services shop. Right, what I suggest you do very, very quickly is ring Trevor. You owe him 38 grand and do it fucking now. Did you hear me? No, you fucking hold on. You better ring him very, very quickly, right, because you're going to cause yourself a big problem if you don't, I can assure you. My name's Ian, all right? That's all you need to... Listen, yeah, don't worry about that. You'll find out exactly what I'm all about, mate, I'm telling you. The sirens are screaming and the fires are howling. We're down in the valley tonight. There's a man in the shadows with a gun in his eye and a blade shining no so bright. There's evil in the air and there's thunder in the sky and a killer's on the bloodshot streets. So we die with the most of our one night together when it's all way to go. We'll both be so alone.
Tucker has broken his foot and has spent the last couple of hours in surgery.
I should have seen for one second.
Not long after regaining consciousness, Tucker decides to discharge himself.
Shall I get some tissue then? Just put the blood.
Yeah.
Can I hold it there while you pull it out, the tissue?
Right, we've got all the we've got your bits and pieces. And on the way. See you soon.
We've just left the hospital. I've now got four broken bones because some fucking idiot just done a U-turn and didn't look right. Just got round this corner and bang! That's where your accident happened.
Despite breaking four bones in his foot and having had major surgery, Tucker believes in the power of self-healing.
It's a burglar.
Much to the alarm of his eight-year-old daughter.
No, I never discharged myself. Why would I do that?
Why would you think for 1 minute I would discharge myself?
To come home.
I love you so much.
What happened to the crutches?
What happened to the crutches? I don't know.
Well, don't you need them?
No, they never give me any.
I'm going to take your plaster off in a minute. You can help me.
No, you're not.
Why?
You have to put that back on then.
Why do I have to put that back on?
Because he's better
now. Oh. Can you get me a knife?
No.
Please, go on. No. It's the beauty of a knife, darling. Honestly, please. That's better. Now we're cooking with gas.
How on earth were they expecting me to walk with all that plaster on there?
Wow. Come round here and have a look.
Oh, come on, come on. Get the camera round here.
Dwayne left the hospital after being operated on. Couldn't walk, couldn't even talk. When they asked the story, he had to get out both his hands.
So yeah, that end's coming up now. See, I need some super glue, darling.
Cause I got two heads, gonna bang my heads together. I got one.
to heaven's door. I got three eyes. I'm gonna pluck one out for Jesus. I ain't gonna have no trouble.
If I just in a minute put some super glue on there, where it's nowhere near the wound, and they're nowhere near the wound, that'll hold them tight. And we can be happy with that.
Tucker has done this before. He suffered an identical injury to his other foot. Housebound, Tucker is reduced to watching Big Brother with his best friend, Doug.
I would definitely go and put her traction bombs if I was her. She's going to go fucking ballistic.
She knows exactly what he carries. Here was the last train of Nashville girl. You got on board. Packed up your medicine. Left without a word. Strung out in suburbia. Waiting for that call. Staring at the wall, sharing your needle and spoon.
After a week on the sofa, Tucker appears to be making good progress. A hospital checkup today will reveal just how well the injury is healed. But the doctors are concerned that he will never walk properly again. Incensed by the news, Tucker puts the word out that he's after revenge from the man who caused the accident.
I haven't moved from here. Right, for over a week now, with my leg up in the air, I've just been told by a doctor I'm never going to walk again properly.
The fact that he hasn't bothered his arse to come and see me in hospital, right, when he was telling me how sorry he was when he knocked me over, just done a U-turn straight in front of me, I need to have a chat with him.
I can assure you, if he thinks he's knocking me off a bike, clean off, with no fault of my own, and walking away as though nothing's happened, I've got news for him. I will terrorise him for the rest of his life.
Tucker has traced the driver to an address in Hastings and has asked an associate to pay him a visit.
If you don't hear what you want to hear, listen, I will take full responsibility for it. Just punch him straight in the nose, mate, and walk away. All right, don't walk away, jump all over him. That'll do. Tell him that I've just come out of hospital after he's disabled me for life. Yeah? And you ain't very happy about it.
I'm going to leave that with you, Mick Lovely. Cheers, mate. Tell him, mate. Bye. By 3 o'clock, I will have justice. I'll give him out of order when I speak to him on the phone. All right? And he was sorry. I'll give him sorry. All right? I say, pass the phone back to my mate. Clump him as hard as you can. All right? And then you just hear crash, bang, wallop.
That's how quick it takes to sort someone out in Hastings. We have the technology.
Arrests are being made in connection with the £53 million robbery, and Tucker is glued to the television.
A 26-year-old man could be extradited from Morocco after he was arrested there in connection with Britain's largest ever cash robbery. He was arrested in a shopping mall in the Moroccan capital of Rabat.
50 armed police around.
Tucker's phone has been busy all day.
Hello. Yeah, mate. Well, it looks to me like they're kicking doors down everywhere at the moment. They've got nearly all of them, I think. They'll be on their way to Belmarsh between them. Listen, I'd like to go and see him, but I'm not going to, the bastard. He never come round here with 980 million, 980. Hey, I'd love to go and see him. And I thought I was one of his pals.
Two men have been charged with money laundering.
Laundering? He never even had a washing machine.
So far, detectives have recovered less than half of it.
Yeah, they've got him, but they ain't got the dough. I would have dug an hole so deep, they would never have found it. Not that it was anything to do with me, mind. I wish it was.
Tucker's trial for possession of a firearm is now imminent. Police raided his home after a tip-off and discovered a loaded gun in his garage. The trial has been delayed while Tucker recovered from his motorcycle accident.
I think from something that the doctor left gaping open, which was a right mess, to what I've actually done with my Steri-Strips, I'm pleased with it, and the doctor was absolutely over the moon with it.
Though his foot may be healed, Tucker now believes his memory has been affected by the accident and he's unfit to stand trial.
I did actually hit the car and obviously go over the car and hit my head. Whether or not the judge thinks it, you know, I'm pulling a stroke or not, I don't know. At the end of the day, I can't remember. I can't... What can I do? If I can't remember, how can I get a fair trial? You know, I can't answer the questions, you know. It's just... You know, and it has put me under a lot of pressure.
Tucker's ever-present right-hand man, Doug, is helping prepare the defence.
Come on, we'll be fucking late. Watching him fucking clean the windows.
Come on, fuck's sake, get in.
Tucker is quietly confident that he'll escape conviction again. But his defence relies heavily on his star witness, Sydney, who maintains the gun as his. It's vital he's available to take the stand, but Sydney is in more trouble.
Weapon, abusive, threatening, abusive behaviour, language, whatever. A few other ones, I can't remember.
He has pleaded guilty and faces up to 6 months in jail. Keen to protect his star witness, Tucker does his best to keep Sydney out of prison.
Whilst waiting to be seen, he starts an argument with another offender who had been reported on probation office. Become verbally, physically abusive towards this man and accuse him of having abused children. The police were subsequently called. Mr. Girling was too agitated for me to proceed with the interview and was therefore encouraged to leave the premises. Oh, I blame the parents.
Sydney escapes a jail sentence. Tucker's luck is in once again.
Well, I've got the interview, word for word, and I've heard exactly what he's had to say in court. And he stood there and quite clearly said that it was absolutely nothing to do with me. It was, you know, it was his. But the fact that he's got such a terrible record anyway, he's not a credible witness, they're saying. So, you know, take everything what you're saying with a pinch of salt. But the fact that he's actually stood there and said that it's his gun, right? It ain't often someone puts their hands up to one of them. If it's not theirs, it's watertight now, more or less.
Ian Tucker is about to stand trial for possessing a loaded gun. He's keen to make a good impression on the jury and knows his appearance in the dock will go a long way. With this in mind, he's travelled to Spain for the weekend to have his teeth fixed.
The teeth are very sensitive. The provisional, okay? We made yesterday, just to cover. We made two kind of provisional. Very nice, and when people ask for a lot of aesthetic, and the usual. These one are the usual, but are okay because he can smile, he can eat.
Tucker has successfully managed to postpone his trial for over a year, but now it's time to face the music. For the trial to go his way, Tucker knows his defence needs to be watertight. But the prosecution have questioned the credibility of Tucker's star witness, Sydney.
But the reason why he was a little bit vague, right, because he was pissed out of his head.
Sydney has claimed ownership of the gun, and his evidence in court would go a long way to deciding Lucky Tucker's fate. After two mistrials, this will be an exceptional third. The jury must come to a decision this time, or else the case will collapse.
The fact that we've now had two practice runs, we're well wise enough now to actually pull through this and hopefully win the day.
It's the morning of the trial. Tucker has been deemed fit to stand, despite his claims that the motorcycle accident he recently suffered has resulted in severe memory loss.
I'm not fit at the moment to go on trial. And mess about with the next 10 years of my life, I don't think. I'm not in a fit state to do that. The fact that I've had a nasty blow to the head and I am having trouble remembering exactly what's what, I don't think I'm going to get a fair trial. If I can't stand there and if I can't clearly remember exactly what's what. I am very, very forgetful now, whereas before I wasn't. I remember people saying to me that, you've got the memory of an elephant. The fact that it's getting on for nearly 3 years now, I can't remember what I'd done in 3 weeks ago, never mind three years ago.
Right, here we go again.
Sydney's evidence is now even more crucial.
The fact that Sydney's going to be there, saying it was his gun, and he was living at my house at the time, obviously goes a long way. He took it there, he left it there, and he's put his hands up to it.
Will he be in court?
Yeah, definitely.
But Sydney fails to show up at the court for the first day of the trial. Tucker's case relies heavily on Sydney's testimony, and it's vital he attends the following day. With so much at stake, Tucker has agreed to collect Sydney himself and drive him to the court. But he's not at home, leaving Tucker to scour the streets.
How are we this morning?
We're Sydneyless. God knows where he is, what he's doing, or what he's up to. What can you say? We're running the case without him. It's, at the end of the day, he's been there twice and said it's down to him, so.
And went in at the end of the last trial, if you remember, as you said.
And had an outburst.
Mm.
I can't be.
Maybe you're better without him, yeah.
I would have thought so, really, looking at it on the whole.
I'm confirming everything, anyway, that he's admitted to.
When did you last see
him? Last night. Absolutely out of his face.
So probably for the best that he's not.
That's the way I'm looking at it, yeah.
You don't want it adjourned, Ian, surely?
I don't want it adjourned. I can't have this going on any longer. Having a fourth trial, it just can't happen. All right, just deal with it. If you have to find me guilty, just put this matter to bed. I can't be doing with it anymore. It's killing me. Right.
Thank you.
I'll see you when I get my glasses.
Still no Sydney. Without his testimony, the onus is on Doug to support Tucker's case. Doug says he saw Sydney with the gun and is very clear on what he will say once he takes to the witness stand.
He didn't know, he had absolutely no knowledge whatsoever of that firearm being on his premises. And obviously, I never seen him with it. Never. I seen Sydney with it, showing it off. Ian, I love you.
Doug's performance pleases Tucker and brings the case to a close. The jury will retire tomorrow to consider their verdict.
We're standing outside Maidstone Crown Court. We're just about to walk in and get the verdict after the judge has done his summing up.
How are you feeling?
Excellent. If we get a 10 stretch today, then we've had a go. We've gone down fighting, and I won't be batting an eyelid. You just leave it to the jury.
Jury are out now, they have retired, probably having a little chat over lunch, and I should imagine if they have a result directly after lunch, it will be within an hour and a half in Ian's favour.
The jury are out and hopes are high.
Just this minute, came out of number 2 court in Maidstone Crown, where my mate, Ian Tucker, has just been remanded in custody, found guilty after 30 minutes deliberation by the jury. Anything involved with firearms, there is a minimum statutory sentence of 5 years. That's just a gun. That's without the bullets, which I believe there's a year, 18 months each bullet.
On the 23rd of May 2007, Ian Tucker's luck finally ran out. He was sentenced to 6.5 years in jail. There is still no sign of Sydney.
Next week, a cautionary tale of two Leicester lads who ended up in a Venezuelan prison for smuggling drugs. They spent 4.5 years in a living nightmare. Banged up abroad next Monday at 10 on 5.